Game of Geeks podcast, episode number 11.
Welcome to the podcast, A Game of Geeks, where living in your parents' basement isn't a bad thing, it's a requirement. And now, here are your hosts, the subject of the 1980s documentary Revenge of the Nerds, Garrett and Dave.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the podcast, A Game of Geeks, the podcast that specializes in everything with swords, fangs, lasers, lightsabers, and everything else that's better than real life. I'm your host, Garrett Robinson, and with me, as always, is your co-host, David W. Wright, Goth Entry, and author of Yesterday's Gone, White Space, and a whole bunch of other really awesome books. I had it on my list of things to do this week to change our fucking intro music. Absolutely did not do it.
You slacker. What were you doing?
I know, I was finding out about having a baby and releasing my first film, and just, I wasn't doing anything. It was crazy.
Jeez.
Yeah, my first film premiered last night. Woo! I got really drunk. Not really that drunk.
So you have a movie out?
Yeah, I have a movie out. It's not available online yet, because it's still doing the festival circuit. It's still doing festivals. I gotta try and get it into South by Southwest, now that I have an inside line.
Is it a legit movie, or is it like a snuff film?
It's a pretty legit
snuff film.
There you go.
Is it starring Zach and you're like both nude and just, you know, some artsy film?
I don't want to give those spoilers. It is not starring Zach, I will tell you that much right now. It's starring four amazing actor friends of mine and also two actresses with slightly more minor roles, which I caught a lot of crap from a feminist friend of mine last night, and I was like, I know, I'm sorry. The next one will be better, I promise.
Too much nudity, or
no. The just that the women were so minor, and they were like, you know, they were both kind of bitchy characters. Like there were no great female characters.
And you were letting out your misogyny onto the
exactly,
film.
Exactly. Oh, okay. Exactly. but anyway, no, it went really, really well, and people liked it. It was part of a whole program, and we got cheers, and I had fun. But nobody gives a shit about that.
No, sure they do. They're here. They're here for us. They're not here for Battlestar Galactica. We should just talk about us for an hour.
We should. We did skip last week, which our viewers are obviously well aware of, but I wanted to mention because that was because it was Father's Day, and David and I are both fathers, and we were like, fuck.
Can you believe that?
I know, right? Who would let us stick our parts in their parts?
Apparently there's no test required for the whole father.
Yeah, exactly. I'm about to be a father third time over. That was,
oh my God.
I know, it's insane.
You need to stop.
I know. Strong swimmers, man. Dude, first, whatever. Nobody gives a shit about this. So
we're trying to have a second kid over here. You want to come over and help out, maybe? I'm sure my wife would mind, but...
But what does she know? She's just the one who has to carry the child.
We'll do, like, a whole thing where I have her, like, close her eyes and stuff. It'll be really romantic. You can make a movie out of it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll film it. POV porn.
She'll never notice a difference between your body and my body.
No, completely not. All right, so let's get on to... we're talking about Battlestar, and for anybody who, for some reason, doesn't know why, we're talking about Battlestar because Game of Thrones finished, and we were like, well, what show should we do next? And nothing was on, and then I was like, well, Falling Skies. And David was like, I'll do Falling Skies. So I watched the premiere of Season 3, and I remembered why I stopped watching Falling Skies in the first place. The fucking show is terrible. It's not the show is not terrible, but a lot of the acting is really bad. I like what's his face? Noah Wiley. Love him. Always have loved him. But a lot of the other actors in the show are bad, and the dialogue is terrible. Like, even Noah Wiley's lines, it's like, you really acted your way out of a terrible line there. Well done, sir. So anyway, so we abandoned that, and we said, you know what, fuck it, let's just do Battlestar. So we're gonna be talking about Battlestar, you know, topical. It's only like fucking 10 years old.
That's all. Well, you know, I've never seen the first, I don't know if it's two or two and a half seasons of it. I caught it late. You know, when it first came on the air in 2000, what, two? Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Three.
When it first came back on the air, I was like, why are they redoing that show? I just thought it was the dumbest idea ever. I loved Battlestar Galactica as a child. I loved the Cylons. I loved the spaceships.
Grew up and realized how bad it was?
No, I actually never did see it since I was a kid. I've not gone back and watched them. But just the idea, whenever anybody takes something you liked as a kid and decides to redo it, you're like, oh, this is going to suck. Yeah. But it was so awesome. So,
it was. It is.
So it's now, I'm starting from the beginning. I know how it ends. I don't remember everything, though, how it ended. So a lot of it's a mystery and is new to me, so.
It's hard to say this because there's so many other good contenders, but like I said, I'm in the middle of season three. Battlestar might be my favorite TV show ever. We had a whole big argument on the storytelling podcast last week. Not really an argument, but like our fans were like bitching at us on Twitter. We love you guys. But they were bitching and they were like, dude, Battlestar is not better than Firefly. Unfortunately.
Yeah, it is.
It is. If
not only is it, it's a lot better.
Okay. I love Firefly.
I've only seen one episode.
Oh, you bastard. I think that we should have done Firefly. Fuck. That would have been awesome.
What, all of one season? What was it, 13 episodes?
Well, it's our in-between season. It's not like we're going to do Battlestar all the way till the end of the show. Like, eventually Game of Thrones is going to come back, or something else equally nerdy will come on, and we'll take a Battlestar break. And
we should do, like, two episodes of Battlestar per week, just to, you know, get through them quicker.
I disagree.
It's gonna take us forever. All right,
I don't have that much TV time. I'm sorry, I just don't.
Right.
I don't. I really do not. I'm not. I'm probably not sleeping tonight. I'm just probably not. Just writing, working.
Well, and you're having a kid, so that's gonna improve things.
Yeah, well, that's not for 9 months. I mean, so that's, you know, whatever. So let's see. Episode one. So starts off with that whole intro scene with the Cylons, and then the lady in red with the hot ass boots shows up, and it's like the Cylons have, you know, nobody's seen or heard from them for 40 years, and then this fucking super hot chick shows up, and she's a Cylon, and
number six,
and blows up everything. Which was kind of cool, but like there's that initial moment of confusion, which was explained in the show, but there's that initial moment of confusion where you're like, she just got blowed up, like, but
suicide bomber Cylon.
Yeah, exactly. But it's like, but why? Because you arrived in the spaceship and then the spaceship blew up the station that you were arriving to. So why not just stay in the spaceship and blow up the station from there? Like, what's the advantage there? And then we found out that it really doesn't matter, but that's for later in the show, so we'll save that.
All right.
So I have to point out a small gripe at this point, which is something that Firefly got right. There's no sound.
Sound in space.
There's no sound in space. There isn't, though. There's no sound in space.
I like the sound in space.
Okay. I will admit that.
Cool. It's muffled, too, so it's kind of like maybe the sound is coming from, you know, just inside whatever's exploding, you know.
Yeah, totally, totally. But it's reaching the, whatever. It does make for, okay, I will say this. Battlestar has the best fucking space fights ever. Ever. Yes. Ever. And we'll talk about Apollo's
and
later.
The best music.
It does have amazing music.
Game of Thrones
music.
And that are very close.
Yeah, yeah.
Bear McCready does the music, though, and he's awesome.
Yeah. And I love how the characters have themes. That's a big, important thing for me on things like this. I first started paying attention to it in like Lord of the Rings, and I know it's been done other places before and since, but like where Gondor has its song and the Shire has its song and da da da. In Battlestar, number six has her song, and the Battlestar Galactica has its song, and the president has her theme, you know, like in the music and everything. I love when they do that.
I want a theme song.
I do too. Well, we kind of have a, you know, we've got this thing.
I don't like that one.
I know. I need.
No, I want a theme song for me, like when I'm walking in a room and, you know, in public.
Actually, that's the least Dave theme song possible.
Find something by The Cure, maybe? I don't know. The Cure, Depeche Mode, but even more depressing. And some goth. Maybe Dead Can Dance, all three combined. There we go.
Or hey, it could be, what do you call it? Drowning Pool, Let the Bodies Hit the Floor.
That's macho rock. I don't give a fuck.
Macho rock.
Yeah. Testosterone rock. I do like rock, but not stupid shit.
Not stupid.
Sorry, all you Disturbed fans.
Zach is texting me totally pissed off about some comment that I'm not thinking, but I'm going to ignore it, and we're going to move on to the next thing. So the
introductory... Oh, he wants to have sex with my wife?
Apparently. So then we went to the Battlestar, and we, you know, got like that introductory. Now they did this thing of one big long introductory shot. It was one long Steadicam shot that basically went throughout the entire ship. I thought it was awesome. I love it when they do that, and it was you know what I'm talking about, right? Where it was
the one shot.
Yeah. No, like the whole big one shot through the ship. Did you notice that? You might not have noticed.
Yes, I did. When they were walking, they showed everybody, and they were like passing various people. And then when they were, you know, passing, when some guy made a comment about old people, they passed the gruff commander. And
exactly. And like, it's more impressive to me because I'm a filmmaker, but those shots are hard. And that was a well-orchestrated shot.
Especially on a fake set.
Yeah. Zach's texting me, what a dick. Okay. His question is, why did the girl ask the guy, are you alive? And I'm not going to tell him because we saw episode one just like he did. So he can figure it out for himself from context.
Awesome.
So anyway, actually,
we're not here to answer your questions.
We're really not here to answer your questions. But honestly, I don't know why she said that. I think she just said that because she had maybe never met a human before, for real.
That was my take.
That was my guess.
She was thinking how much like a Cylon it looked.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I
mean, and she was also very impressed with the baby she found and then murdered.
And I was literally watching that, and I'd forgotten that happened, and I was like, oh, Dave must be having all of the orgasms right now. Every orgasm in the world is erupting from David's penis. that was... Ugh.
I'm not that dark, man.
You're pretty dark.
No.
What do you mean you're not that dark? opening scene of White Space? Season
it wasn't a baby.
Okay, I'm sorry. You're
the
right.
The baby did not get killed in White Space.
Okay. Or did it?
No.
But
she was doing it as an act of mercy, it seemed.
Yeah, but considering how many people managed to get off the planet, how did she know that the baby wasn't going to get off of Caprica before it died? Huh? How did she know? She did not know. She killed the baby.
You know what I think? I think she killed the baby because she thought the mother was stupid. And she's like, this baby is just not going to have a good life. It's like when I go to Walmart and I see people like they should not have kids. You know, someone should just, you know, mercifully remove them. Not the kids, the people.
Okay, there we go. I can't respond to anything that you're saying because it's just shutting down the logic centers of my brain.
Sorry, the
empathy centers of my brain. Yeah, exactly. David Wright, Cylon, ladies and gentlemen. Put that in your subtitle on your goddamn card, which I don't have. I'm jealous. So we get an introduction to the Battlestar, and we meet the captain, the commander, rather. And we learn... I really liked how they introduced everything on, like, the Battlestar is really out of date. There's no networked computer systems. There's no... there's no, you know, advanced computerization or anything, because it's from the Cylon Wars 40 years ago, and in those wars, the Cylons could hack anybody's computer system. So the captain's like, no computer networks on this ship at all, at point ever. I thought that was kind of cool because it makes them like old and antiquated, but still super badass.
And that's why, you know, they were spared from a lot of the disaster. They were.
Exactly. Because otherwise, when those raiders showed up, you know, they would have just hacked into the system and taken everything down.
I do like, as a pilot, I thought it was very well done in the fact that, you know, they usually when a first episode of a TV show, you have to find a way to introduce the audience to the various things. So the way they were doing it was saying, well, this is going to be a decommissioned ship. So right. You were meeting the captain. It was all very, very well done. And just everything was in place very nicely, I thought.
Yeah. Yeah, they did do a really good job with that. And then, okay, so they had that. Apollo showed up. The dynamic between Apollo, like right off the bat when I started watching this show, Apollo got me. I like his character. He's
swooning?
Huh?
You were swooning or?
No, I just like him as a character because I don't totally like him because he's a little bit of a dick, but he is basically a good guy. He's a complex character, and they got that right off the bat. Like, see, you know, two or three scenes with him in the whole show, or maybe four or five, and you get that there's a level of complexity and depth to his character that I think he was the best character exposition on the whole show. He has going on than anybody else.
I think his father is a better character.
I think he's a better character, but in terms of like character development, like for me as a writer, you know, like his dad's just the old battle axe who like runs his ship and won't take shit and everything like that. And that's cool. I love the commander. He's so badass and awesome. But Apollo's got so much more going on, and that they managed to do all of that. You know, his anger at his father, who he blames for the death of his brother, and his disdain for the ship and it being sort of a relic, and then his acceptance of Rosalyn as a president when he sees like, oh no, she actually knows what the fuck she's talking about, and he accepts her and he's like, this is my president, and then going against his father's direct orders as his commanding officer because the president's saying something else. It's like there's so much going on there. It was really cool. And he did have the best fucking thing, like the space flight in the episode when he led that missile away from Colonial One.
Yeah.
You remember that whole part where he, like, the missile's coming in and then he swoops in and leads it away with his heat signature and then he flips around and shoots it? I literally was just like, oh, that was fucking awesome!
I was thinking Starbucks is better, but that's not until the second part of the pilot.
Yeah. Okay, so we were gonna watch the pilot and the pilot was in two parts, and Dave actually probably correctly watched both parts of the pilot, and I just watched the first part.
I wish I knew. I was like cramming trying to get 3 hours in to do it.
Yeah, well, the other thing is that's a lot of show to talk about, and we generally only do a 45-minute show, so I kind of wanted to keep it a little bit more controlled. But
so we could talk about ourselves more.
Yeah, exactly. I wanted the show to be very, you know, like on topic, and it's not.
You're with the wrong co-host.
Exactly. okay, and going on the cast of characters, so the chief, the deck chief and Boomer were fucking, which was probably against regulations since they had to do it behind closed doors and everything like that. But I thought that was, you know, kind of cool. Like, just their whole, like, their whole arguing thing, you know, where she's like blaming him for the gimbal and everything like that, and then he uses that an excuse to like go off into another room, and she follows him and locks the door, and then they just start boning. I don't know. I thought that was funny. Somebody said that a more honest title for Battlestar Galactica would be "People Fucking in Space."
It is very soap opera-ish.
Yeah, I guess.
But I like that.
Yeah, see, the thing for me is that soap opera, like, when people say soap opera, they generally mean, like, the interconnectedness and, like, no, I'm your father, no, I'm your lover, no, I had sex with him. But to me, soap opera just means bad acting, and there really just isn't bad acting in this whole damn show. Like, there's nobody who I'm sort of like, eh, that guy was phoning it in, you know?
I thought Starbuck was over the top for the first episode.
Really?
Yeah, but I guess it works for her character. I just didn't understand why she was so angry in the first episode. Boomer didn't really, you know, get much of her in the first episode, so I'm not sure.
No, yeah. Well, actually, in the first episode is where she had to leave, right near the end, she had to leave Hilo behind on Caprica.
Okay.
That happened right at the end of the first thing, and that was
reminds me of Phoebe
intense.
Cates, which is a good thing. So,
who's Phoebe Cates?
You don't know who Phoebe Cates is?
No, I don't know who Phoebe Cates is. David just came, or
oh my
had a heart
God.
Attack?
Both. Have you seen Fast Times at Ridgemont
High? Best heart attack ever. Yeah, of course.
She's the dark-haired, beautiful one that took her top off. She's married to Kevin Kline.
How does she remind Boomer?
Yeah, they have a similar sort of look to me. I don't know.
She wasn't Asian, was she? Because, I mean, you know, Boomer's very Asian.
Phoebe Cates is, I forget what her nationality is, like Hawaiian or something. She's
really?
She's not American.
I need to rewatch Fast Times.
I mean, she grew up in America, but she's ethnic of something.
She's Hawaiian or something. She's not American.
They have a similar look, and both are beautiful.
All right, good.
Anyway, Phoebe Cates. Yeah, well, okay. Well, hey, if you could go on about Emma Watson for God knows how many damn shows you've talked about her.
Emma
Watson. I can mention one person.
Holy shit, Emma Watson. Dude, okay, so let's talk about Emma Watson for a minute. No, let's not. But,
I didn't even know there was Emma Watson news to talk about.
There isn't, but there's always Emma Watson to talk about. God, one day, like, if I do become famous and I, like, run into her at a party, it's going to be so awkward. It's going to be bizarre.
Yeah, when you get home and your wife murders you.
Yeah, well, that too. But if he gives me a chance with Emma Watson, it's totally worth it.
Wow, we got to get your wife in here. We got to have a conversation.
I know, right?
Do you have a star that you're allowed to be with? Do you have that arrangement?
And yeah, we actually have five.
Five?
Dude, it's from Friends. There's a list. There's a list.
Okay, pause the show. Who are your five?
I'm not pausing the show. I'll tell you right off the bat. It's Natalie Portman is my number one. Emma Watson's my number two. Olivia Munn is my number three. My number four.
God.
What?
Olivia Munn?
Olivia Munn. Are you
know who she
kidding
is.
Me?
Go
why
ahead.
Why do you go meh? No, tell me why you go meh.
She's always I like her. I've watched her like on Attack of the Show, and she's on Newsroom and stuff. Like I like her, but she, I don't know, she just doesn't strike me as a fun sort of, I don't know.
Oh, she strikes me as such a fun sort of.
All right, go ahead. Who's the rest of your list? Not that Natalie Portman is fun at all.
Are you kidding me? You've never seen her rap video, have you?
Yes, I have seen it. I've seen most of her stuff, so I like her. I like all your people. Go ahead. Who's next?
After Olivia Munn, shit, the four and five always get kind of hazy for me. Kind of changes depending on what movies I've just seen. Evangeline Lilly. Evangeline Lilly is number four.
From Lost?
Kate from Lost.
Okay, all right.
OMG. And then Emma Stone. Got a thing for Emmas, I guess. I don't know.
Okay, so you got all brunettes and one redhead.
Yeah, I guess.
All right.
I didn't think about that.
And your husband. Your wife, does she have a list?
My husband, he does. No, I'm just kidding. Yes, my wife has a list. All I know is the first two, which are Tyrese Gibson and Vin Diesel.
Wow. So she likes the exact opposite of you.
Absolutely. Completely. Yeah.
How does that make you feel?
It's fine. My wife doesn't look like any of the people on my list either.
Well, she's a brunette, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, I mean, I haven't seen much of your wife, so I don't know. Anyway, okay, on with the show.
Yeah, let's talk about the show. So back to Starbuck being kind of over the top or whatever. I think, like you said, I think that's just in her character. And I love how much she and the Colonel hate each other and how clear that hatred is.
I like him.
You do? See, yeah. you like him because he's fucking like...
Well, he's a complex character, and you know that there's more to it, and he's like really a nice guy deep down, and I like those kinds of characters.
Oh, no, he's not a nice guy
He is. He's a great guy deep down.
No, he's not. He's a hard-ass guy who gets shit done deep down.
You interpret it the way you want to interpret it. Me, I see him like holding
You've
a kitten.
You've seen the end of the show, right?
Yeah, he's holding a kitten and... Reading bedtime stories to orphans.
That's not happening. None of those things are happening.
I do like the little bit of foreshadowing they showed when he was, I won't say what happened in case anyone's following along, but when he's using a cigar to burn a hole in a picture.
Of his wife?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You get where that's going? Okay.
Yeah, I hope so. that was definitely pretty cool. But he ejected 100 fucking people out of an airlock. Like, holy shit. Who hasn't sacrificed 100 lives to save the ship? And that's one of those things that I do love about Battlestar, and I know you guys have talked about this on Better Off Undead before, is the tough decisions that have to be made in this show. And there are a lot of tough decisions, and there's a lot of tougher decisions to come, but it's like they killed 100 crewmen to save the ship and hundreds more, which it's like, yeah, I mean, what else are you going to do? Let the ship die?
Well, that was rough. It's a battle star. It's war.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, that was pretty rough. Trying to see what else happened on Battlestar.
Let me find my notes.
I want to talk about Gaius last.
I love him.
Oh, he's such a good character. The moment when they realize that the Cylon attack is actually happening and everybody's just like, holy shit, because like the captain and Colonel Ty have fought the Cylons in war before and nobody else on the ship has. They're all like a bunch of like 20, 30 somethings, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That was so crazy. Like, because to them, the Cylons are kind of a bedtime story. You know what I mean? It's like they're the boogeyman. And now they're fucking here invading. And, like, the reaction from everybody was great. I thought that was just fantastic. And the urgency they had to get everything going. You know, like, all of their modern Vipers get destroyed. And they break out those old Mark IIs. And, like, they let Starbuck out of the brig and everything and go, like, bust them out and everything. And it's like, why don't we launch from the starboard hangar bay? It's a gift shop now. Frack!
I do have to say, the spaceships for the Cylons are so horrible looking. Really? I love the old... The big helmet! I mean, that's just stupid. That's the worst spaceship in all of TV.
I think it looks fucking dope. I think it looks super fucking dope.
Give me the old ones. Give me the original ones. Those are awesome.
Googling a picture right now.
I don't like the big fucking helmet.
Okay, are you talking about this thing? Let me share it. One sec.
Don't pull your pants down again. You tried that before the show started.
Zip. You're talking about... If you're not watching the YouTube, you're missing out here.
Yeah, you should always be watching the YouTube.
Actually, we get way more YouTube watchers than we get audio listeners.
Yeah, that's a motherfucker. That's awesome. Kind of looks like a Millennium Falcon sort of smaller version.
Yeah.
Slash UFO.
Okay, so I'll give you that's a pretty cool looking ship. I like the new ones, though. I think they look super badass. Anyway,
it's a helmet thing. I like the rest of it. I just don't like the damn big ass helmet head looking thing. That's just why do that? That's stupid.
Well, okay.
Anyway,
I don't want to spoil it, but I know why they do that. Don't you?
Oh no, I don't know.
Do you mind if I tell you?
I guess if it doesn't ruin anything for the listeners that are following along.
Remember if it becomes important in the show or not.
All right.
It is a Cylon.
Okay.
It's just like the Centurions, like the robots and everything. It is a Cylon. There's not a Cylon in there. It is one. You know what I mean?
So why do they need the helmet? What, they could have done something. I mean, they can make a Cylon look like a human. Why not make it something without the stupid helmet? That's just dumb looking. It looks like they were out of ideas. What do we do for a cockpit? Put a head on it. Yeah, a big helmet. Looks like a fucking those bobbleheads.
But it's not a cockpit. That's what I'm saying.
Well, then you don't need anything. You don't need anything at all there. You don't need a head.
But you see the thing where the visor comes down and that little scanner comes out and it jams their frequencies. That's what that thing does.
Ah, they could have done something without that.
All right, fine. So Dave doesn't like the Cylon ships. Fine.
I do love the visor, and it goes, I want one of those.
I know, right? Dude, how badass would it be to be a Cylon for Halloween? Fuck. Okay, so...
Oh, Carl Sinclair just said he has two of the original toys from when they came out. Oh, I want one.
Yeah, of course he does. He's a super geek. Super geek! Super geek! He's super geeky!
Ow, wow, wow, wow. This show's going off the rails.
Really is. We got to move along.
Let's talk more about who you're going to sleep with.
Oh, I could talk about sleeping with...
Zach's on your list, isn't he?
On my list?
Oh, yeah, people you're allowed to sleep with.
I bumped him to number 6 after I found out who Emma Stone was.
Oh, okay.
No, I bumped him to number 6 after Emma Watson became legal.
You're a horrible man.
I am a really horrible man. My children are never allowed to watch my podcasts or my films. That was actually one thing is like I said, because they had a little filmmaker Q&A last night, and I was like, yes, another piece of art I will never be able to share with my children. So anyway, all right, let's move on to Secretary Roslin, who by the end of the episode became President Roslin. I don't know if she's a cool character or not. I mean, she's dying with cancer, so my sympathy nodes immediately go along. But
I would have put her in the airlock.
She seems out of her element, that's for sure.
Yeah, she was the education?
Secretary of Education.
Yes, and suddenly she's the president? That's a pretty big fucking leap.
Yeah, well, yeah. But I mean, you know, when everybody else is dead.
I don't know. I think I'd put the guy, Adama in charge. I don't know.
No, you don't want a military president. That's the worst thing in the world.
You hold on. You don't want a military president when you're at war against the most fearsome things ever. Yeah, I want an education person. No, fuck that. I want somebody that kicks ass in charge.
Yeah.
I'll put Teague in charge.
Wow. Then the human race would die. All of them.
We've got to detonate a nuke in the middle of humanity to stop the Cylons.
Holy shit, that was a pretty good Colonel Ty impression. I was shocked that came out of my mouth. anyway, she seems out of her element, but she also is like, I respect that she's like, well, if I'm the president, then I'm going to do what the president thinks should be done, and I'm not going to let somebody tell me not to do that.
I like her later in the series. In the first episode, I didn't like her quite as much. I don't know. I don't know what it was I didn't like. Doesn't matter. Anyway, next.
Anyway, let's... I even have a note here. The Cylon ships look so awesome.
I have a note that says they look so dumb.
Okay, how about... Okay, so let's start talking about Baltar. Talking about Baltar. He's an attractive man. No, he is so
dreamy?
Self-centered.
Oh.
Dreamy, self-centered, self-dreamy centered.
I know you like the accent.
Yeah, sure, you know, whatever. I know from later in the show that this actor can fucking cry on command. He cries so often in this show, it's kind of ridiculous. I'm like, oh! Baltar's crying.
He is a weasel, but...
He is a weasel.
I do like his character.
And I like his relationship with number 6, which, you know, and she's so aware of everything that's wrong with him. She's like, the fate of your entire world hangs in the balance.
Now,
all you can think about is yourself.
here's my question. Is that really her in his head in the beginning? Or is it just him projecting and, you know, because he's a little mental?
Well, it's not a spoiler because it's not really a question that the show raises until, like, you know, whatever. It's her on the planet. I know that because later it becomes a point that somebody saw him with her.
Okay, so why then did, why did she point out the device that was on the spaceship? Does she want to save him and all those people?
That's technically episode 2.
Yeah, okay.
Which we said, which we weren't going to talk about yet.
All right, okay. Yeah. See, I watched them all together, so fuck me.
That's fine. Spoiler alert for episode 2.
I love spoiling alerts.
How many people are watching this right now that you think have not yet seen, no, that haven't seen Battlestar Galactica?
Oh, I have no idea. Probably none. Yeah, if you if you haven't seen Battlestar Galactica and you're watching this show, well then, yeah, but you spoiled episode 2. Zach just started. Yeah,
okay. Well, I spoiled my, I was just showing notes because Wade asked if I took notes.
Oh, nice.
It wasn't a big spoiler.
My, thing. Why is nobody talking to you on Twitter or what?
No, no, I'm looking at the YouTube comments.
Oh, fuck me. No wonder. You're, like, talking about all these comments, and I'm like, the fuck?
I have somebody in my head. I have, like, all of our listeners are in my head.
Yeah, seriously.
Numbers 1 through 4.
All 4 of them. Sorry, I'm just pulling up the video now.
Oh yeah, people were commenting on your choice of women. Wade said Jennifer Aniston.
Really? Even now? I can understand in the 90s, but even now?
What do you mean even now?
Oh, she's just aged. Lucy Liu used to be on my list.
Aged?
She's older now.
What, are you saying older women don't count? Well, look at
I'm
you,
just
you
saying that,
bastard.
I'm just saying that I do not find older women as attractive. And most people, I think that's true.
Oh. Wow.
I'm not going to be called weird for this one because I...
Okay, first of all, she's not an old woman. I don't know how old she is.
Older than she used to be. She's in her late... 40s might be in her...
No, she's probably in early her 40s.
Maybe early 40s.
So is that... What's your line? Like, you know, 24 and that's it? They're done? They're old? They're out?
No. Just when I...
Wow. When I first sexist see picture, and ageist. Okay.
When I first see a picture of them or see them in a film and I'm like, that kind of getting on. I don't know. She doesn't look great to me. That's fine. That's all I'm saying.
Because she's gotten older. You liked her when she was younger.
Yeah. Hey, listen, fucking... Wow. Dude, Carrie Fisher used to be hot. She's not now. Guess why? She's old!
She also got very heavy, so two things. Oh, so you what? You don't like fat people, Dave?
I was gonna say, pot, stop talking about the kettle.
Carrie Fisher is like 70. There's a distinction between 40 and 70.
Right, but when Carrie Fisher was 50, she was also not as attractive as when she was playing Princess Leia. And Jennifer Aniston is not as attractive as she was when she was playing Rachel. That's what I'm saying.
Wow, you are so Hollywood.
No, I just know what I like.
Apparently, Emma Watson, when she was 13.
I wouldn't kick Jennifer Aniston out of bed for eating crackers, but she doesn't make my top 5. That's all that I'm saying.
Can we have your feminist friend on next week?
Recycling list. No, absolutely not.
We have a fun show, busting your balls.
And now Carl said, I'm with Garrett on this one too, 90s. Or they've aged out. I don't think that's necessarily true either, because there are... I'm sure I can list some. Okay, maybe not. That just got really boring. All right, so let's keep talking.
Too old for Garrett.
Are we really talking about this right now? Can we go back to talking about Gaius Baltar?
Yes, let's.
Wade, she's hot. I'm not saying that... If given the opportunity, I wouldn't do anything. I'm just saying she's not top 5. That's
No. You said she was hideous. She hit the wall, and you know she should be put out to pasture. You were talking about retirement.
Never left my mouth. So. Retirement homes for old Hollywood stars. That would be the most depressing thing ever. Because they just all sit there and talk about how they used to be big and used to be in movies. Oh, I'm getting sad just talking about that.
Isn't that true of all wow. retirement homes anywhere? At least they have stories to tell. And no, people that like, maybe had no life really don't have a story to tell. And that might be even sadder. Like, oh, I could have been something.
Yeah, but I mean, then it's like, you know, they usually build their lives around their families and their children and stuff like that. And, you know, so like there's that. But then, you know, like Hollywood is an industry where it's like you everything's so based on your body that it's like, oh, I used to be young and beautiful. And
yeah, we can see why people like you.
Yeah, well, I mean, hey, some people do really, really well with it. Like, you know, Meryl Streep still looks just as good now as she did when she was 40, and she's a tremendous actress and will, you know, like, hasn't had to work for years and just does amazing, amazing shit. Yes, thank you, Carl Sinclair. Claire Forlani, 90s hottie, still hot. But let's stop talking about all of this stuff. Dave, you are so bad at trying to get back on topic.
I'm watching you all fall down, man. Just alienate all the female listeners. I guess there are none, though, are there on this show?
Yes, there are. There's plenty
women
of
don't
female
like you.
Chrissy's probably watching.
Well, what if Chrissy's over 40? She might feel like, oh, I guess I don't count. I don't matter. I'm so horrible to you.
Can we be done? you're not even though, because it's like you're saying just the most ridiculous things. It's like that's complete. Ugh, God.
No, I'm simply following the logic that you've already laid out.
No, you're not.
Yeah,
she's not on my top five list of people. Like
that's not how this conversation started. You need to rewind and listen.
No. How it started was somebody was like, "Dude, Jennifer Aniston should be on your top five," and I said. Really? Even now? Like, in the 90s, she would have been on my top five, but she's not anymore. That's how this conversation started.
And then you, like, trashed her and said how damn old she is, and she
did not say that. Did not occur.
And you said you might throw a mercy fuck?
I think...
You're a horrible man, Garrett Robinson. With a zero.
I think we're actually pissing off the listeners, Dave. We should probably get back on topic.
No, we're not.
No, we're probably not. So
they live for the train wrecks. All right. I'll shut up now. I will let you talk.
We have 2 minutes to wrap up this show.
This show on your own, too.
We have 2 minutes to wrap up this show.
All right.
What do you want to talk about? We can talk about whatever you want to talk about for 2 minutes.
How Emma Watson has hit the wall.
This is what I do with my children. Time to go to bed. You have 2 minutes. 2 minutes to play, and then we're going to bed.
Nobody puts David in a corner.
It's because you can't wedge him in because the corner's too tight. The rotund shape. It's like trying to fit a round peg into a square hole.
Oh, and now the fat jokes. Oh, it doesn't end with you. You're like Hitler.
Gaius
Baltar, I believe.
Gaius Baltar.
Did we get to the end of episode one? No, I want to get to the end of episode one.
Absolutely not.
Okay, go ahead.
Good.
Get to that.
So Gaius Baltar.
Dick.
Unwittingly, it's true, but helps the Cylon humanity and then flees from the resultant new... Once again, let's reiterate, he caused, finds Hilo and Boomer, who land on the planet, and Hilo gives his seat to Gaius Baltar because he's a great scientific mind. Oh, the irony. That is so fucked up. I was just like, oh, Hilo, no, he, oh, that sucks.
Horrible man.
He is a pretty horrible man. You know, whatever. That's one of the awesome things about this show. His character has so much to go through. So much to go through. You haven't seen season 3, right?
I don't remember when I came on. I remember around the time, I don't want to give anything away, so. It was when it got really fucking good, though.
Yeah. No, it was, Gaius in season 3 is like, some of the best TV. But, okay. All right, so let's get to the end of the episode. So now, Apollo is with Colonial One. And he's got orders from the president to handle handle rescue operations. And Commander Odama, who's now, you know, head of the fleet, commands everybody to go meet up at an ammo dump so that they can resupply before they go wherever the fuck they're going to go. And Apollo is like, I have orders from the president. Nice pink bar, by the way. That's amazing.
Read what's underneath it.
That's amazing, David. So then Colonial One and Battlestar. What is so funny?
That I was able to derail you without even speaking.
Okay, so and then Battlestar, which is like way too far away to help, notices that, you know, Cylons are bearing down on Colonial One, and they come, and Apollo goes below and sets off the EMP, and the EMP basically takes them off of the Dratus, and they all disappear, and it looks like they were destroyed, which, spoiler alert, they weren't fucking destroyed. Like, they're not going to make this character present and then kill her in the same first episode. So we'll find out exactly what happened in episode 2. Yeah. Well, you know, like, the show tells you it's just an EMP. But, anyway, it was first episode. It's one of probably my second favorite. I love the Lost pilot, but this was really good at introducing you to a wide range of characters, making you care about all of them, and really setting up the whole story. It was really awesome.
I'm torn.
And David's reading the YouTube comments.
Yeah, I'm torn whether Lost or Battlestar Galactica gets my top spot. I'd have to watch Lost again. I haven't watched the Lost pilot since I saw it the night it came on. So.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. It's such a good pilot. It's so, like, holy shit. So, anyway. Can we end this train wreck? I'm so done with this episode.
Let's end it. Let's hit our EMP button.
Hitting EMP button now. This has been a game of geeks. I'm sorry, everyone. I'm really, truly sorry. For anybody who's watching for the first time, I have a new podcast, What the Hell is Garrett Doing? It's on this YouTube channel. It's going to be on the audio feeds, and check it out, because it's pretty cool, and you get to hear what I've been doing all week.
And
bye,
you
everyone.
Can hear which women
See you
he
next
hates.
Week.
Hey, you didn't say my website!
CollectiveInkwell.com.
Bastard.